provide a view on how platforms have driven changes in the evolving business models, this morning I'm going to be talking about the evolution of platforms, how they evolved and why they evolved, and the key benefits that I'm trying to provide advisors. I'll be talking about platforms of today and also platforms of the future and the key considerations due to technology. The evolution of platforms. Before platforms, we live in a world where we called brokers, we called advisors, we manually placed orders, we faxing requests, and we manually select funds for investment. This tended to form a part of an advisor's value proposition, having access to investment information and research that clients did not, and also be able to execute on it. And all this got a lot easier to do with technology, and the focus shifted from investment selection and execution really to broad-based financial planning as we know it today. Platforms change the status quo. They provide an online platform to manage investment portfolios and administration. Back in the earliest form in 2000, platforms were created for efficiency, aimed at removing back office administration and an online platform to enable this for advisors. Over time, platforms further improved administration and efficiency, reduced the cost to serve, and allowed advisors to grow their business without eroding value. Powered by platforms, advice practices were able to decrease the administrative load and also add value-adding services such as research, strategy, client management, and most importantly, face-to-face time with their clients. Powered by platforms, advisors could also scale their businesses. Platforms offered online platforms giving clients access to investments such as wholesale funds, listed securities, and a broad range of product structures. As platforms evolved, so too have investment and portfolio management capabilities with auto cash management, auto rebalancing, and bulk rebalancing tools. Reporting. Platforms provide an online method to manage client portfolios and access information online. The suite of reports created off the back of internal portfolio management reports focused on investments, performance, and most importantly, tax reporting. As you can see, since they entered the market more than 17 years ago, platforms have evolved considerably. Each iteration has driven change for advisors and advice practices. The evolution of platforms was driven by efficiency, focus on administration, and reporting. If we move on to platforms of today range from full service investment super and administration platforms that offer different products and services across the whole spectrum. We now essentially have full-service wrap platforms on one end and direct equity trading platforms on the other. Today, the technology evolution is creating full-service digital platforms that are able to cater for clients and advisors more holistically. Platforms are able to provide portfolio management services across multiple different models, whether they are custodial or non-custodial services, and across a full range of products, including trading, investment, super, pension, and obviously managed accounts. Platforms today are focused on efficiencies for advisors, on how they manage their clients via bulk processes such as auto cash management, bulk switching, and bulk rebalancing. The increase in offers such as managed accounts is assisting with efficiency and providing advisors with efficiency, transparency, and scale. One of the many trends in the industry right now is the rise of Robo 2.0. Robo 1.0 being the likes of Betterment and Wealthfront that use convenient technologies to enable the opening of accounts, the investment of those accounts, and then managing portfolios along the way. Robo 2.0 is really about focusing on those capabilities and providing them for financial advisors with the benefit of being fully integrated into a full-service platform. Advisors' focus has shifted over time due to technology, as technology has made legacy tasks and processes much easier to perform. In regards to experience, platforms of today are designing features and functions not only for investment and portfolio management efficiencies, but also looking at the end-to-end digital client experience. Clients feel more empowered than before. Majority of consumers feel, regardless of what platform provider they use, they are like a great client experience in any market segment or industry. We all know each generation has different drivers for the use of technology. Baby boomers want trust, Gen X want convenience, and millennials want immense personalization. Having said that, Millennials in the US, a research has shown recently that even though they use technology and it's second nature to them, in terms of when they talk about or think about large financial decisions that need to be made, they're not turning to robo-advisors. They're looking for advice and looking for advisors to give confirmation and comfort. This is why capabilities and platforms are critical in supporting the overall experience and the value proposition for advisors. Integrated ecosystems. Platforms will be key in leveraging the benefits of open banking. But the current trends that aggregate off-platform data, leveraging open banking, will enable an opportunity to highlight the need to really be part of an open digital ecosystem. This will enable financial services and the environment where consumers can take greater control of their data, disseminate their data, and be provided with additional offers, services, and products through advisors. Platforms today are focused on digital experience, investment efficiency, and integration. Now, if we move forward to platforms of tomorrow or the future, in the future, digital platforms will form part of ecosystems that we believe will interact like marketplaces and cater for all business models moving forward. We'll see platforms as an essential way that advisors will be able to enable their business, providing efficiency, transparency, and scale. We see no different to the same drivers and reasons of why platforms have evolved over the past 10 years. Portfolio management is, or will soon be, a commodity service. Platforms of the future will be integrated seamlessly into a client's ecosystem and provide entire wealth value propositions. Platforms will be omni-channel, omni-device, and completely API-driven. With open banking protocols, platforms will provide for a more complete, holistic client experience and enable advisors to have a single client view. The adoption of cloud technology, big data and AI will provide broader coverage, greater insights and less bias. This will enable the automation of research, investment selection and execution. Platforms of the future will be digitized and they will automate the complete investment lifecycle. Platforms will be on 24/7. They will allow advisors and clients and platforms to interact and access platforms via the preferred digital channels. Being connected. Platforms of power how businesses provide services. Think about the big techs like Facebook, Google, Amazon, who power platforms with many different users and service providers in and out of financial services. The same will apply for full-service platforms in wealth management in the future. The use of technologies such as voice recognition, voice biometrics, and integration with open APIs and open banking will truly provide for a digital open economy. This will require advisors and practices to rethink the servicing engagement models with clients and cater for digital savvy, digital native millennials who are very open and comfortable with the use of different technologies. Finally, data. Data will drive all insights, they'll drive all our experiences, and they'll enable opportunities for platforms to provide more holistic views to advisors. The use of data and AI will enable insights and allow advisors to engage with clients not only on their financial goals and their financial well-being, but also to know about a client's personal views, their interests, habits, and off-platform assets. In summary, platforms of the future will enable financial advisors to generate real-time predictive insights, have the next best conversations, allow clients to manage their financial well-being on their own terms, and advisors will focus on different value drivers and become more sounding boards and life coaches to their clients. We will all need to consider new value propositions and adapt our strategies for the future. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Always a very comforting feel you get from Macquarie. Okay, our next guest who's going to challenge this a little bit is Arnie, and I'm just going to set you up, Arnie, now for your presentation. Arnie, is starting with a little video? Ladies and gentlemen, Arnie Selvitraja.
Thank you. How do I make that larger?
Maximize it, Arnie.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
Oh, here we go. All right, I'm a Mac user. Yep. There you go.
And then down, yeah, and then down in the full screen.
Yep. Right. Cool. Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Good morning. Enda talked about comfortable and being comfortable, and there are some people who are here to comfort the inflicted, but I'm hoping that I can inflict on the comfortable a little bit. I'm also very excited about Matt's view on VR, because that's going to save me a whole lot of money in family holidays going forward. So anyway, we're going to talk a little bit about the alternative universe. And I wanted to share with you an idea, and this is an idea that Steve Case wrote about probably about early last year, I think. And Steve Case is the co-founder of AOL and was the chairman of AOL Time Warner for a while as well. And he talks about the three waves of the internet. The first wave really being the building of the internet, and some of us in this room were involved at Bankers Trust back in the day, and were involved in the team that created the BT wrap. And I remember, back in 1999, talking about this revolution, spelt with a W, and we talked about how exciting the internet was going to make everything, and it was going to change the whole industry. Roll forward 17 years. And it's changed a little bit. And I think the big issue here is that it takes, technology can change, but people need to change as well. And that's the limiting factor. So in the first wave, we talk about the internet being built, and that's the infrastructure, the foundation, the connectivity. The second wave, he talks about being between 2000 and 2015. And that's really the creation of the app economy, moving to mobile. And that's really been driven by people, by products, and more importantly, by platforms. So the second wave was really about creating these closed platforms which are trying to be all things to all people. But effectively, the platforms like Amazon, like Facebook, Twitter, etc. The third wave, which is, I believe, the wave that we're in at the moment, is really now about moving to a partnership model. So this is where there are two emerging models or two emerging providers in there. They are the providers, the best of breed providers in their vertical, and they're the facilitators who bring those best of breed providers together to create the ultimate client experience and to create the ultimate service offering. And that's the model that we are moving down in terms of creating our service and our offering to the marketplace. So that's the context around what I'm going to talk to you about today. But I just wanted to share some information from you and what's going on in other parts of the world. So just talking to you a little bit about what's going on in the US, particularly in the IFA space, there continues to be a move away from the institutional marketplace into more independent financial advisors. So as it's happening here, it's happened in the US as well, but happening at a lot faster pace. So there's this huge move to independence. And I think that move to independence is really about being more flexible in terms of creating genuine, ethical, morally based client outcomes for clients. Secondly, there's robo-advice. And Matt touched on robo-advice a little while ago. Robo certainly hit the US market in a big way. And what we saw post that is some of the large incumbents entering the robo space. So you see Vanguard and Schwab enter the space, particularly because they started to understand that acquiring clients in the US was becoming very expensive. So although the digital experience was there, the technology was there, the actual ability to convince clients to actually use that technology wasn't. So the big winners in the robo space have really been the incumbents, so the Schwabs, the Vanguards of the world. In the financial planning space, very much moving towards goal-based planning. So those are objective-based outcomes rather than behavioral-based outcomes. So really taking a quantitative level to how we're engaging with our clients, helping them to understand the outcomes of the decisions that you're advising them to take. And lastly, a search for alternative investments. So very much because of where the market is at the moment, certainly in the advice world, they are trying to find investment outcomes which are negatively correlated to the equities in the bond market. That's slightly more difficult and also slightly more dangerous because we're starting to move into kind of the derivatives world. The bad news for advisors is that fees tend to fall in these environments. The good news is because there's more technology being applied in these businesses, the costs are coming down as well. So although the fee momentum is downwards, margins are not ultimately being affected too much at this point in time. Oh, I'm stuck. Ooh. Sorry. I hope you don't get too dizzy. The upside is that, interestingly, in the US, the millennials have started to engage again with advice. So 73% of millennials are now saying they will engage with an advisor as long as they can engage in the way they want to engage and that the fees are reasonable. So there is still this pressure on fees, but at least they're thinking about advice. So in my view, advice is alive and well, and I think the pendulum has come back. We started pre-GFC with those clients being advised. They swung to robo. They've understood now that robo actually isn't everything that it said it was going to be, and they've moved back to a hybrid model. What they've seen in the US is that where robo is bound or is delivered together with an advisor, they can lift the average balance from $35,000 to $350,000. When they're that robo is combined with a group of advisors. So in a call center type environment, they're lifting the average balance from $35,000 to $150,000. So certainly robo is now being seen as something that you deliver with advice. But effectively, it's delivering advice using technology in a digital way. But digital is not as easy as you think. So to deliver real, good advice and good client engagement through using technology, you've got to get a lot of things right. And that's why we're thinking around partnership approaches, because what we're trying to do is think about getting best of breeds in each of these areas, bringing them together so we can focus on delivering the client experience rather than trying to be, deliver a 60% solution across all of these areas. And here's a couple of examples. Morningstar's already started talking about a model marketplace. In this context, it's generally their own models, but certainly there's another company in the US called Riskalyze, and they are creating what they call a partner store. So they already provide a managed account solution, but they are now bringing different model managers to bear, but completely on an open architecture model. So it is happening in the US already. Back in Australia, the dynamic we have in our marketplace is where we've got a client base and an advisor base that doesn't have a high expectation of return going forward. So this puts a lot of pressure on in terms of the service delivery to their client base. Naturally, if we're in a low rate environment, there is going to be pressure on fees because clients are sensitive to the ultimate return that they're getting out of their service from you. Despite that, there is still this increasing allocation to listed investments. And this is basically information from, and I'm sorry you can't see the bottom of that. This is information from Investment Trends, and this is the amount of new money being allocated to listed investments. So in 2016, it was 24%, 2017, 29%, and the expected allocation in 2020 is 35%. And of those numbers, the fastest growing segment inside of that is managed accounts, going from 5% in 2016 to 7% in 2017, and expected to be 10% by 2020. And this is based on information from advisors. So what are we trying to solve for? We're trying to solve for downward pressure on fees. And we're doing that by trying to create services for our advisor clients. We've got about somewhere between 700 and 1,000 advisors who use our platform to transact on behalf of their clients. So we're adding services and capability onto that platform that means that they can deliver those services in a more digital way. So as fees come under pressure, they can also take costs out of their business. We have I catch up with 12 to 15 advisors every couple of months across the country, and we talk about what's going on in their business. 2 years ago, they were telling me that the most challenging thing they were facing was the regulation and the increase in regulation and the cost that is driven into their business. Over the last 6 to 8 months, that's disappeared, and the thing they're talking to us about now is the fact that it's really complex for them to actually make the investment decision. They don't know what to recommend to their clients given where markets are at the moment. And that's an issue for them because that really goes to the core of what the service they deliver to their clients. So that's something we're trying to help solve for them as well. Matt talked about this earlier. It's really the inefficient advice delivery, the SOA, the opt-in, a lot of that's being done in a paper form today, and we're looking at ways that we can help to solve that part of their issue as well. And lastly, this is nothing new. Clients have been demanding greater transparency for over the last 8 to 10 years. But this is transparency around fees being paid, but also around where their investments are in and how they're performing. So that's the kind of landscape of what we are solving for. And so what are we doing about this? We're effectively creating a solution, taking a partnership approach where we're putting the advisor together with an investment committee or a number of model managers together with our platform to deliver a service in a managed accounts way. It's not necessarily in the same way that it's been delivered today. As Ender intimated, it's on an individual HIN model. So keeping it as flexible and as open as we possibly can, letting the advisor focus on the client engagement and the client servicing, getting best of breed in terms of providing models, but also an investment committee that sits over the top of those models, and then using the platform to do all of the heavy lifting around the providing research, allocating the portfolios to clients, rebalancing those portfolios, creating automated SOAs, which are driven by the rebalancing transactions, monitor, manage and execute the trades, performance reporting, and in some contexts also do some of the administration if required. So really that's all I want to talk about today, but taking a different approach, but the key difference being in doing it in as most flexible a way that we possibly can.
Thank you, Arnie. Thank you. Thank you, Arnie. Thank you, John. So we've got 15 minutes for questions that we can put to both guys. I'm going to kick it off. And the first question I have is, what is it about your model that as we start to adopt this new technology coming through, that's going to be hard for the other model to replicate?
I think I'm on. So we've been thinking a little bit about this as well and thinking about generational change for the advisors. And the model we are creating is one where they can offer a very limited type of service to the children of their clients today who don't want advice. So they can offer them a direct model, HIN-sponsored, and the child, the son or daughter, can effectively trade on their own. At some point, those portfolios will come to a size that they will need some advice. And there's a natural progression then and a natural lead into the advisor to be able to provide that advice. So there's a generational opportunity to shift that client from one that isn't getting advice today, but getting all the other services like data feeds and tax returns and administration to one where there is advice and it could be then just effectively transformed or transitioned into a managed accounts model, all on the same platform.
Does this mean we're going to see a Bell Acorns service coming through?
I don't know. Maybe I should employ you and you can tell me.
I am getting 16.5% from my Acorns account, so bear that in mind. John?
For us, I think from a platform perspective, we obviously think we've got the broadest capability set in the market. Like my presentation, we are thinking of the platform as an open ecosystem, so we are designing for open architecture, open APIs moving forward. And we think, we've talked about Robo a lot this morning, but obviously we've had owner's advisory, and for us to integrate that into the platform, we see it as a key way to drive out differences between what we provide and what other platforms provide.
Now, given the growth of the SMSF market, and that's now, I think, a third of all assets in the industry, what is it about your approach that's going to service that fast-growing and attentive market?
People might not know this, but obviously on our platform, we also cater for non-custodial trading as well. We've got a Vision Trading Account service, so we do HIN-based trading, that's custodial and non-custodial. So I think with our capability set and our overall platform and product offering, We obviously see we can service SMSFs and their needs and the complexities they bring with them.
I think we all know that if you look at the SMSF segment and the types of investments they hold in their SMSFs, they are drastically under-diversified. So at the moment, effectively, they're, you know, it's solved by direct equities to a large extent or large chunks of cash. So one of the things we are building, and Matt alluded to this, is the ability to actually create these portfolios, not just with direct equities, but with all the asset classes. So it's a multi-asset portfolio that allows them then to get better diversification. I think the message is getting out there. I think they're starting to understand that they need to think outside of just domestic equities. So our platform certainly will allow them to invest across in all of the asset classes.
Okay, and John, you briefly mentioned open architecture there. What does open architecture mean to you guys, and how do you see that affecting or changing your platform? And same to you, Arnie.
Yeah, I think historically, everyone will know platforms in general, full-service platforms have been quite closed in terms of what they've built in the past and the products they've offered. I think with the changes in technology, we're definitely thinking about open architecture, and by that I mean not only technology to open our data and our services to the broader financial service community, but also about business architecture and really being open in terms of having best of breed products, the best choice of product, and making sure that we stay relevant. It's kind of what I mean in terms of open architecture.
Okay.
I think in financial services, when we hear open architecture, we think a clip along the way. And that's certainly not how we're thinking about it. So open architecture for us is being able to plug and play as many best-of-breed providers so that the client gets the ultimate best experience. But the other thing we're thinking about is how we also make it open architecture in terms of pricing. So as we partner with those providers, the pricing is transparent, and the client's clear on the value they're paying for which part of those things. We've taken that approach in our Bell Direct business today. It's very much you pay for the things you want to use rather than pricing being bundled. So certainly we're trying to disaggregate pricing as much as possible.
So Matt presented a slide at the beginning that talked about the industry's focuses on managed accounts, et cetera. And he talked about that being inverse and needing to focus on things like the very sexy technologies and tools and processes, AI, et cetera. What are you guys doing to bring any of that technology onto your platform?
So we've always taken an approach that you've got to get something in front of a client and then understand how to iterate that offering to match the way they're using it, how they want to use it, and then evolve that as they evolve. I think technology is great. I'm a huge supporter of technology, obviously, given the business we're in. But I think there's a human element that we have to keep considering, and that people don't do things just because they can. They do them because it makes sense to them and it's easy for them and it's convenient for them. If you think about the advice industry today, half the industry is probably 55 plus in terms of the clients you're servicing. Probably a third is 65 plus. So I'm not surprised that advisors still want to send paper copies of SOAs. Because we see, as I said, we've got a large number of advisors with clients, and even getting an email address for some of these clients is difficult. So in an age where we're moving towards that way, we're not 100% of the way there yet. So I think you've got to pick a segment of those clients and evolve with them, but you're going to have traditional methods of working with the older set, and that will change over time. So I think that's a limiting factor.
Yeah, I think that's interesting, Arnie. I mean, if you're 55, you're probably the first generation who owned a ZX80 PC, but you are there at the birth of the technology revolution. So you talk about it as if it's going to be a slow process, but do you not fear it's going to be a very rapid change and you get caught out?
Look, I suppose I'm in two minds. I know 80-year-olds who are using technology and iPads and whatnot, and I also see 55-year-olds who don't. I have a classic story where the CIO at ComSec used to get his PA to print his emails for him so then he could write the reply and then she would send them for him. And this was someone who led the technology of a very innovative business. So I think, you know, in the client bases of the advisors in Australia, there's going to be a huge range of people and a range of level of comfort with technology. You can't force that, is my view. You can show them what's possible and show them what's available, but I think you can't force that pace of change.
Okay, in the interest of time, I think I'll try to get the floor to engage in conversations. Do we have anybody who wants to ask a question?
Matt's going to slam you down.
not at all.
Get ready.
I read somewhere recently that there's now more ETFs in the US than actual stocks. And interested in your comments on where you think ETFs, LICs are going and how that's going to change the platform market.
Yeah, there's a view from the active management community, and then there's everybody else's view, so obviously there is some concern around the size of ETFs and the level of automated trading that occurs behind the ETFs. I think there'll be a natural balance to where it ends. ETFs are a very efficient way to get access to asset classes. We are in an environment where we are focused, you know, our clients are focused on lower price, higher efficiency. ETF solves the problem at the moment. The slight difference in the US, Matt, is that in the ETFs, in the US, they actually trade ETFs, whereas in the Australian market, we use them as an investment product. So that does worry me a little bit because it intensifies the algorithmic trading that occurs already in the US market. So I think the right answer is what we're doing here and that we're using them as an efficient way to get access to these asset classes.
Do we have any more questions?
Sorry, but I don't believe it's the only way to invest. So I think it's a balance. You've got to have a little bit of active and a little bit of passive and to create the best outcomes.
John, do you want to tackle that one?
Well, that's a tricky one. I think from a platform perspective, from our perspective, we don't really care in terms of financial instruments. We think whatever is most efficient for clients to get the best advice, the way we kind of are playing the game. I do agree, Arnie, that in Australia, we do use ETFs differently to the US. Having gone to the US in July as well on a trip, the market's very different to ours. But I think from a platform perspective, as long as we can make sure we provide efficient and cost-effective investment and choices for our clients, that's what we'll be doing.
Ender, I've got a question if there are no other questions from the floor. And it has to do with the issue of open architecture, which both of you spoke about, and Matt as well. Apart from the institutionally owned advice businesses, I can't think of an advice business that's got a chief technology officer. So, you know, in the mid to small-sized advice businesses, so technology in a lot of advice businesses tends to be either something one of the principals is interested in or it's the default solution of Xplan and a platform of choice. So my question is, and I do have one, my question is, in an open architecture world, do you think that your prospective clients are in fact resourced to deal with open architecture and all that that implies in terms of assembling the technologies that support their business?
I think currently probably no, but I think moving forward, as platforms become more open and we do have open APIs and we do have more of a community in terms of building out applications and services from platforms and consumers, I think it will definitely help advice practices to have that scale and the expertise where third-party providers will give the expertise. You don't have to have a CTO in your office to do that. And we think the evolution of technology will provide more of a marketplace where you can pick and choose the services you need.
Our view is a little bit different, Toby, in that I talked a little bit about the two types of service providers, one being the providers of these best-of-breed solutions, and then the other set of providers being the facilitator of the client engagement to the client. So we believe that we'll be one of those facilitators. and we will work with the third-party providers to ensure that the engagement for the advisor is going to be as seamless as possible. So they won't need a CTO. We'll be their CTO for them, and we'll do the integration and the back-end kind of plug-and-play for them.
We've got time for one more question. Anybody down the back?
Hi, Nick Furtick from Avaloq. And just a question for the panel, if you wouldn't mind. We've been in the industry for a long time in the technology side. My question is more around unified managed accounts, this whole view of the US pushing, moving from an IMA to a unified managed account, a household. How far off are we to that model, if you like, in Australia?
I think it depends on what you want to call a UMA versus an IMA or SMA. But I think compared to the US, we're probably a bit way off. But I think it also depends on the instruments and our regulatory environment here as well. I think it's just hard to say that we'll become what the US is in terms of their UMAs and how they trade them and how they utilize them. But I think in the future, I do see managed accounts becoming much broader than what they are today in terms of the instruments they include and how they will provide value to advisors.
I've got nothing to add, really.
Great, thanks.
All right, I think we'll wrap it up there. Thank you, Arnie. Thank you, John.